First time I've had a place to set my beer.
Dangerous.
I find a lack of facilities here, so I have to do it sort of by back to the paper era. Sort of like the computer and video system in this room is the same vintage as your audio
stereo
system.
Yes. Yes. Very late 70s, yes.
My talk is about how music works, and this is the third part of it. I've been curious about music for a long, long time. In fact, I hate to admit it in a way, but it's kind of fun to think about. I was brought up in a just about totally non-musical household. My interest was in electronics and then in audio first. And while I was interested in hi-fi, because it was the thing back around that time when I was a teenager, well, what do you play on your hi-fi? And so an interest in music actually came from an interest in sound, which is really backwards. And some of the first music that I listened to is really embarrassing to think about. I met friends and moved on and got educated and became very interested in music. And I did try musical instruments, but never became a player of musical instruments. And so I'm still a non-musician. And so I've been looking for the answer. What is there to music? How does it work? I enjoy it, but why am I enjoying it? How should I listen to it? Should I read the newspaper while I listen to music in the background, or should I be intently on it? Am I supposed to cry? What's supposed to happen here? And what is it about music that does this, as opposed to other art forms such as literature, paintings? I've sort of come to the end of my attempts to figure out what music has got, and in summary, my conclusion is not that much. The subtitle was, it's got a good beat and the kids can dance to it, and that's pretty much the conclusion of all three parts of this. This is for a non-musician. I have to keep reminding you, probably still will. Who is the music audience? Well, my conclusion is non-musicians. Just like me, or a lot like me. There aren't that many musicians to listen to themselves be an audience and the performers as well. So the question is, why do they or we listen? And number one I come up with is, quote, feel good, unquote, entertainment, sort of like comfort food. You know, why do we eat? We do have appreciation of the skill of the performers. I consider this to be very high, composers and performers. It can be an emotional venture to some degree. We often sing. Even musicians or non-musical people really do sing or chant or join in group things or dance along. Dancing, everybody dances, except for me. I don't dance. Also, another reason for listening is because you want a good story, and the story is likely to be a movie nowadays, and it has music, and that adds a great deal to the total experience. So I've got some now bad or irrelevant activities or views that don't help us learn anything about why music works or how music works and this sort of thing, what to expect from it. Number one is snob appeal. I go to the Detroit Symphony, you know, 6 or 7 times a year, and occasionally other symphonies, and I just like classical music. I'm in awe of the sound of it, but I'm sure that some people I see there just like to be seen and like to be thought of as music goers. I don't consider myself in that class. So I consider that off the track, not a getting to basically why music appeals. I also see a lot of emotion being spent in hand-wringing and so on and so forth. It was so beautiful and all this kind of thing. It affects me to some degree, but it, not that much. Oh, some kind of a proper socialist statement. That's more of the same, being seen and so forth. Music accompanying art, this is what Byrne was alluding to. And my position on this is that while it's nice, contributes nothing in understanding the power of music alone, if there is any. You watch a film without music, and it really lacks. You put a good score with it, and it really rocks. And I don't deny it, but I consider that to be some kind of a multimedia thing. Analyzing the music is something different entirely. Okay, I also have background music that's while you're reading the paper or whatever, and music for growing plants and so forth is bad ideas. I think they've gotten rid of a lot of that.
Grocery stores now playing things like Beach Boys 60.
Yeah.
Dave?
Yeah?
I recently made a short film for the purpose of advertising. And we made the film without a background score. And the background score was added for a pretty pragmatic reason, and that is there are a lot of incidental sounds in the soundtrack that we wanted to mask. And by putting in a musical score, we replaced a bunch of random sounds with a pleasurable but fairly nonsensical, you know, that most musical background music in films is pretty nonsensical and very simplistic. And we did something like that, and it contributed very significantly to, I feel, to the effectiveness of the advertisement. In fact, the advertisement was...
I'm not denying that, but what does it tell you about music? What does pure music on its own, why can that communicate in some way with us at all?
Is that rhetorical, or you want to answer?
No, I said what you said doesn't do that. It doesn't shed any light on it, whatever.
Well, I think it does, but very indirectly. I think that
it's too indirect. I've only got half an hour.
The book that conditions my thinking about music more than anything else is called "This Is Your Brain on Music" by Daniel Levitin. I don't know if you've read it. I consider it to be probably one of the most thorough and
I've brought along some books that I have read that I think are relevant to it, and I might as well show them to you now if anybody wants to take a look at one. Isaac Asimov, you can get into why that's ready. Music Cognition, Music, the Brain, and Ecstasy, Diana Deutsch, Psychology of Music, and Consciousness Explained.
Consciousness, Ecstasy. You answered it. Just the titles of the books.
They're not the whole answer. Now, I've read the books, and I pulled something out of them, and I have an answer stated as an answer. Mm. Not something that, well, it's so good when it accompanies a film, or there's a nice story to latch onto, or something like that.
Certain tunes, whether they're a movement of a symphony or a nostalgic thing you heard as a kid, mean something to some of us, not all of us, such that when I hear that movement of a symphony or that piano solo or whatever it is, whatever style, it conjures back past life where things were different. It becomes more of a mental thing.
Well, more of this, more of that. It's all non-music. Mm-hmm. I'm saying, what does music itself do? How does it work? Should we expect anything from it? You're saying it reminds me of my childhood.
Well,
that's nice.
Or,
so does an old car, and so does an old painting, this and that.
I think nostalgia is a very important factor to me.
Okay. It's, but it's only irrelevant to understanding of how pure music works.
Okay, so you tell
are
me
you
which,
are you saying that?
Go ahead and explain what cells in the brain do what and how it communicates or whatever.
Okay, thanks. That's what I'm here for.
Okay, here's your
answer. I do appreciate the questions because I had those and I had to sort them out of my head in order to get down to what's going on with pure music. A lot of music I hear at the symphony, I'm hearing it for the first time. Some of it I like and some of it I don't like. Now, when I like it, why do I like it? What's it doing for me? So forth. I think I'm on to the answer. Sum up line of the paper is it's got a good beat and the kids can dance to it. But first is a step at this thing, consciousness. After looking at it for quite a while, particularly this book about consciousness explained, I accept the definition of consciousness as the ability to ask oneself, what shall I think about next? This is something that implies consciousness, that it exists. It's like, I think, therefore I am. That's a very conscious statement. And what is thinking? Well, it's being able to think about, what shall I think about? This is a very human activity, one we like to do a lot, is daydream and think about things as they might be, just let our minds run, not have a task at hand that we're trying to solve. This phrase, what shall I think about next, it is a concern about the future. It's very important. Language is required to formulate this phrase. It doesn't have to be English, but the bottom line is only humans have it. And so another long-standing feud with Mueller and I is, are things conscious? In Mueller's world, which maybe he'll get over someday, animals are a little less conscious than humans, plants a little less than animals, and rocks even less yet. I draw the line. I say anything subhuman isn't conscious, whether they're dolphins, porpoises, chimpanzees, what have you, because they don't have a spoken language, and we think in our language. We don't think in grunts and groans and dislikes and so forth. So the question is, how did we become conscious, and when did we become conscious? And my conclusion is we got smart in terms of intelligence and problem-solving ability and so forth quite a long time ago.
Last week?
basically a million years ago, somewhere between 500,000 and 3 million years ago. So natural selection provided that. The brain was a survival tool, and a more intelligent brain was used by our predecessors to solve survival problems, as was happening with everything else, except we kept going, so did some other animals to degrees, but the next step is a whole different thing from natural selection, really. It's pre-wiring of the brain, where you learn certain tricks, survival tricks. They're so effective that the race is called out very fast. Those who have some of these tricks survive, and those who don't survive. And it's kind of analogous to the way humans adopted dogs in the last 20 or 30,000 years. Dogs that had the right behavior got to live, and the ones that didn't, well, probably became dog food.
Or got eaten.
Dog food. This evolution of pre-wiring of the brain, which in dogs are sort of things like a male dog lifting its leg to pee, and that being somewhat effectual and effective in finding mates, and this kind of stuff, just habits that they have.
Marking out their territory.
Yeah, why did they lift their leg?
You don't have to lift your leg,
they don't pee on themselves.
It's, the girl dogs don't do it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes, they do.
Well, can I make a statement here? I mean, most girl dogs don't do it, and my boy dog doesn't always do it. He squats too sometimes. So, but there's a strong tendency for them to do it. All this is an example of survival tricks. But then we have humans developed as apes and chimps and so forth have community living for task sharing and language. And probably we were at the forefront of that group. And by living and grunting together and combing lice out of each other's hair and this kind of stuff, task sharing, these animals began to communicate with each other by necessity of living so close to each other. The next development was that this helped produce was language. And language is incredibly important because it doesn't require pre-wiring of the brain. The young humans, once they start learning this language, now all kinds of ideas can be communicated to them via language. Stuff that is far beyond evolution, way faster than evolution. So I have down here the speed of teaching and learning, evolution at the speed of teaching and learning. Then a very big thing happened about 20,000 years ago, 30,000 years ago, civilization. Civilization was basically cities and farms and crops and so on and so forth. But we had archival knowledge. We learned to take language and convert it to a written language, a written representation. Then incredibly fast development happened in 20,000 years. If you take 20,000 years to today, 21,000 years, that's nothing in terms of Darwinian evolution, but an incredible amount has happened. And well, we're on to something new. We've continued to build on the knowledge of other people with Bronze Revolution, Bronze Age, and Industrial Revolution, and so on and so forth. Now we have the Internet of Things. And this is where Isaac Asimov comes in with his 50-year-old books were about robots that essentially did everything for you. And now that we have toaster telling the coffee maker to start up because the human likes toast with the coffee, we have some concern about maybe going backwards in what we can do for ourselves. In fact, if I were to just find myself in the middle of a field with nothing around except mice and plant life, I'd have a darn hard time surviving. I'm not sure I can start a fire with dry twigs. You know, I've got some hunting skills and so forth, but mainly without my 12-gauge shotgun, I'm kind of at a loss for them.
Remember, you're twice as old as those people were who tried to do
He's
that.
He's twice as smart, too.
Well,
you talked about Clark.
Yeah. That's how we got here, and that's consciousness and an idea about the future, possibly, where machines do more than just pump water for us, but they actually start making decisions for us. Then again, I have, you know, what is consciousness, and my note about humans only, and humans have been, I estimate, what I'd call consciousness, which would be really a fuzzy concept at the beginning, for about 100,000 years. Consciousness is experiencing the past, what you've done, thinking about that, thinking about the present, where am I now, which is really the immediate past, and the future of what am I going to do next or think of next simultaneously. And this results in planning, anticipation, and movement through time of thought and your body. This idea of movement through time being related to consciousness is the concept that I find most powerful. It is something we like. Humans just naturally keep doing it. Nobody has to force us to. But music is a perfect example of an activity that allows or encourages this movement. I cite tapping of foot or fingers to the beat of music, dancing, either participating or watching, performing music. And incidentally, I'm a big fan of watching musicians sawing back and forth and and the conductor doing his thing, and all this as a way of listening to music. It keeps me on track and focused on it, and I experience it better either at live performances or watching videos of it. But then we get down to conducting, like my friend Mike McLean. He just can't sit still. He's always conducting the orchestra, anticipating what they should do or something. But then we get down to vacuuming and doing routine tasks. A lot of people listen with earbuds while they're vacuuming or picking up things around the yard or whatever. And questionable, is that maximum enjoyment? Well, I tend to say it is, because you are moving, the music is affecting you, and but it's not a real big deal. I question what I do on some Sundays for a couple hours is sit and basically don't move at a concert. Just sit there and stare straight ahead while these musicians on stage are having all the fun dancing around. I think that is probably a bit artificial, going to a live concert.
But you mentioned that you have thoughts during that time. And so it's your brain that's active rather than your muscles.
I accept that. I accept that if it works. But I do see that while that's always true, most enjoyment of music is accompanied by motion.
I disagree.
Okay, now I have a slide titled Movement in Music. Diane Deutsch and this Professor Bregman at McGill University and so forth, and some others, they talk about groups and what they call grouping mechanisms. And Diane Deutsch goes into it in really depth, presenting different signals to the two ears. Once you identify something as a group that's progressing in the right ear, even though it switches to the left ear in its presentation through headphones, you're still hearing it in the right ear for a portion, as long as it comes back. The sensation of grouping is that strong that it can actually supersede what the nerve impulses that are generated in your ear, that is, the ear-brain system, hears differently from what actually comes in the ear itself. The biggest thing in music that is grouped together is rhythm. A steady beat, a waltz beat or something like this, it allows you to keep time to it, and what's coming up next, you do that, you enjoy that. Another one is melody, though. And I say the king of melody is Wagner, and with these long horn and Wagnerian tuba stuff, morbid usually. And but another one is harmony. Two instruments playing together, making harmony, or simultaneous notes on a piano or some such. They may have an identifiable harmony that, even though the melody changes, means a certain thing to you. Tone color, instrumentation, timbre, all of these things can be an item that you follow through other changes. So also loudness and position. All these come originally from you know, ability, survival abilities to identify prey or your environment or whatever and deal with it and protect yourself.
But what we consider rhythm and harmony are cultural.
No, they're not.
Why is it a person who's used to the
because rhythm
China,
rhythm
and here's what sounds like way off key.
Rhythm can come from
notes that are
Dave, I'm going to answer your question. Okay. Rhythm can come from walking or running or swimming or doing any number of activities.
Well, yeah. Harmony versus dissonance is my question.
Okay, then harmony. Harmony is due to two notes being within one critical band, which is actually in your cochlea on the basilar membrane, a resonant rise that's physical.
And why is it we like the 12-32 and over in the East they like something way different?
No, they don't. No, they don't. Vern and I researched this a couple of years ago and we conclude that they don't like anything that's different. There's no fundamental difference.
Their melodies are different, certainly.
Oh yeah, lots of things are different, but not the tones. The basic tone is separation interval is an octave. And in an octave, all of the harmonics of musical tones line up. They're all at the same frequencies. And this sounds consonant, and actually we just call it the same note when they're mm-hmm. an octave apart.
How about the African quarter note?
If you want to approach two notes on the same tuning curve of the basilar membrane, they start getting dissonant. And that happens to varying degrees with varying notes. And there are graphs of this. We tend to use in earlier music and Western music more consonant things. That's my half hour, but I'm almost finished.
I think I have an idea of how to approach what Dave is saying.
Make it short.
In India, for instance, they claim to have 100 different tones per octave, microtonality. Mm-hmm. And it turns out when you do research on that, many of their microtones are not reproducible. It ends up, they end up doing around 12 tones per octave as well.
Yeah. A natural division is 12 tones per octave because many of these 12 are basically show degrees of dissonance and consonance. Dissonance and consonance generates a basic stress or mood of the thing. And as you point out, you hit the wrong ones and it sounds dissonant where you didn't expect that. And that's what you say, they're singing off key. That's really what that means. It's just a sloppy way of saying wrong pitch. Around the world, they may use 100, but they only use a subset of the 100. And basically, the 12 tones come awfully close to everything you can do by dividing up an octave. Not perfect, but awfully close. They're all explainable, forming groups of things that you can follow. Now, these groups move through time, and that movement through time is identifiable, like coming from one kind of instrument or one melody or something, and that's called a string. A piece of music contains a series of strings all happening at the same time, not too many, but a series of them, and that Bregman calls an auditory scene. They're simultaneous strings, and you can follow each one via like cocktail party effect or whatever, diverting your concentration to it. But composers grab our concentration and make us follow one preferred one. And they have things that split and recombine. The sequence of scenes in a piece of music, well, is the piece of music. That is my explanation, that it's all based on consciousness. And my dog doesn't care what I play. It's got no appreciation of music, whatever. Just thinks it's too much background noise. So that's the end.
Put some howling on.
Get a different dog.
What? The dog's howling?
Yeah, I mean, he doesn't like your music, but maybe he likes
I haven't found it.
My friend had a dog when we used to jam, and this dog would howl whenever we played Satin Dow. Only that tune. That dog would howl when we played it. Can't explain why.
Yeah.
Has anybody ever done any experiments where, so you have a pet like the dog, and you make some push buttons that a paw can hit, and you have each push button creates either a dissonant or off key or something, phrase, and see if in time they can be trained to like certain things and dislike certain other things. Run in the room and they can run and push buttons.
I don't really want to talk about dogs, I want to talk about humans.
Yeah, you can.
And I was very struck by one of the phrases in your early presentation where you weren't quite sure if each human experiences the same thing out of music.
That's right.
I have continued to watch NBC's The Voice, and I get quite a bit out of what the coaches say, what the candidates say, but I don't seem to get the same thing. The coaches, particularly Pharrell Williams, tend to talk about very emotional things and the emotional content of the way the singing is done. And I don't quite hear it, but I do hear that Pharrell improves the singing of the candidates a great deal by the things that he says to them. I think the candidate singers and the coaches understand each other on a way that I don't quite match.
I do suspect people are different, but there's an awful lot of, what can I call it, self-stimulation or something that's going on in listening to music. I've talked, about sound systems and about using music to evaluate sound systems to a group of audiophiles in England. Martin Collins was in the audience, and I said, try not to be emotional. Try to listen to music objectively and use it as a tool for evaluating this audio system because you're being paid and that's what it's for. They just looked at me. Not listen to music emotionally? And I'm getting, that's how they evaluate audio equipment. Whatever turns them on gets the fire started and gets it going. That's the piece of audio gear that
don't
they like.
Do you think LTT users fell in love with the whole darn thing after a while? Familiar. I did too. I thought it was great.
Well, that kind of goes to the Letevin theory of enjoyment of music. He basically wraps the whole thing in memory. And he says that our enjoyment of music comes from hearing a familiar sound. Which begs the question, why is it that people can enjoy or not enjoy music that they've never heard before? And I think the answer is...
It's right in here. It's what I've been saying. If you look at it a little differently and interpret it.
Well, this time I'd like to answer.
Mm-hmm.
Play your card. He said, I think what's going on is that music is not all that different from other music. All music tends to have some similarity to some other piece of music that you've previously heard, and it kind of all ties together in a big long string. And so it kind of begs the question, what makes a song popular? And I think what makes a song popular is it sounds a lot like the current crop of popular songs, but not so much that it's repetitive.
But if it's country music, it's repetitive. The country music songs sound almost exactly like the last one.
Well, that is a common comment for people who are describing a genre of music they don't particularly groove on.
Dave? Yeah.
Many times in the studio, if it's a semi-professional, amateur group, whatever, they don't come with a producer. So I often assume that role of producer, which basically means listening somewhat critically to their musical performance capabilities And if the singer is singing a little flat, as tactfully as you can, you'll mm-hmm. point that out, so on and so forth. The biggest challenge in those sessions is finding where the bar is, because the last thing you want to do is indicate something beyond what they can achieve. So you cannot set the bar so high, such as you've worked with some juried professional from a day or two before, but find out what, if this is a church praise group or something like that, what in fact are they capable of, who may be the weakest link, and yeah, there's different things you can do, dialing them back in the mix if they've got a bad note or something. The computer automation is wonderful for that. But more than that is just getting the best you can.
But isn't that exactly what the group leader ought to be doing?
No, the group leader, they're busy playing. Mm-hmm. You can't, for instance, the group leader of the River Raisin Ragtime Review is the tuba player. And very high quality musician, but during the takes, he's busy playing his tuba.
He should be listening and I disagree.
To a degree. But after every take, he will say, okay, time out, who played a wrong note? And the musicians will come for, oh, D sharp in measure 32, I hit a wrong chord in the whatever, what else? Okay, I did so and so. And just literally log these on his score. So he's trying to play the role of producer as well. You know, I may react to certain things like, you know, broad brush things like ensemble or something like that. And say, you guys haven't yet come in together for the coda or something like that, and try and get them to do a retake of the ending to get that dialed in.
In the chamber groups that I play in, I'm typically the worst player, because I always try and accumulate people who are better than I am. It helps me. But the leaders in our groups invariably will have no problem saying, Mueller, you got to tune that note.
That's true.
I mean they know what's going on.
Mm-hmm. Do they also play?
Yeah, of course.
That's a little different in a chamber situation that you describe, I think, than some of what I'm dealing with. Some of what I'm dealing with may just be solo vocalist with piano accompaniment, you know, just a duo of some sort.
Okay.
There
is no leader in that.
That ability to do both tasks is not universal.
No.
Sure. It's the same, they call, I forgot the term now, piano players talk about it, the independence of the two hands, that they can work two melodies at the same time.
Mm-hmm. I may just be lucky that I've chosen as a leader of the groups that I'm in as somebody who can do that. But, on the other hand, maybe I'm so bad that it's grossly obvious.
No, it's always a challenge, because if I am there acting as producer, suddenly I feel self-conscious that they think I'm running up the bill by asking them to do it again, because mm-hmm. I get paid by the hour.
Yeah.
And I'm always cognizant of that. Thinking,
sure.
You know, you guys are great, but if you care, well, once they realize that in fact you are giving them something constructive, mm-hmm. which you always have to do, they may ask for more, and I always tell them it's just the power of suggestion. If you don't want to hear about it, I'm happy to shut up and push the record button, and that's it.
You know, I can see where your input as to, well, the microphone is picking up, your levels are too high, your levels are too low, or, you know, those kinds of things. But in terms of your timing is wrong, your intonation is wrong, gosh, that's something they really ought to be doing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Some can and some can't.
Okay, well,
so if there's not, as I say, another producer there, which may be in the band, as you say, in the group,
yeah.
Not filling that role. And in fact, I just asked them up front, do you want suggestions or not? I'm happy to just record and do the best we can. And most commonly they will say, oh yeah. What the scary part is, when you have a very serious musician in there, and I'm thinking very specifically of Bill Balcom and Joan Morris.
Yes.
As a duo that I've worked with for years and years. And here I am, and they asked me to do it. Because we've worked together enough years, there is some mutual respect for the ears and so on. And Bill will look up afterwards, how'd we do? Mm-hmm. you know? And I will tell him as tactfully as I can, Bill, you need to let Joni drive the bus on this. You're pushing her in the tempi a little bit. Let her, and the sense that she is in fact pulling you along, because Bill does have a tendency to rush.
Yeah.
He will tell you from the very beginning that he's not a piano player. I can think of him saying it out there, I'm not a piano player, you know, and his typical A-type interpretation. And sure enough, he does sometimes pull her along, and she can usually follow. But for the type of song, you could understand that it makes more sense mm-hmm. for the vocalist to pull and yeah. the piano player yeah. to follow.
Yeah. Well, you know, there's a duo that's absolutely top notch. So I have no.
That's right.
No
that's
argument
right.
to make there.
Yeah, yeah. But there are just certain things that you can hear in the control room
sure.
if you're not concentrating on performing. That may be an asset.
I wonder if the environment of a live audience versus a studio changes that perception. Somehow.
Absolutely. Absolutely, Bert. Because what my sense is in the control room, in a studio situation, is they got no audience. How is a musician used to playing live going to emote with no audience? Who are they bouncing their ideas off of?
Because you do get that feedback. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So I've got to play not just engineer, but I've got to play audience in that sense.
Yeah.
And tell them, oh, you guys are hot today. You guys, you know, it's pretty awesome. And give them some constructive feedback, or at least some reaction.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the worst, not worst producers I've worked with, but there's one producer I've worked with who is this very droll guy. And after the symphony completes, just an awesome cadence, with good energy, this is down in Mexico City, and they play with a lot of passion in Mexico City. Finishing a take, and I think it's pretty awesome, and it just reminds me of that Maxell ad where the hair is blowing back and the lampshade's ticking over, you know, from the energy of the music. And Thomas will get on the talk back, and the brass were a little early and such and such, and the percussion's a little loud and so on. I go, man, give these guys some feedback that they were, in fact, awesome,
mm-hmm. yeah.
given a few flaws musically. But that, again, is where you're going to put the bar in your performance. And but then, you know, there's the editing process, and that's how we get through to assemble their greatest hits.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody's dinner time.
Yeah.
Are we done? Should we thank David again for
yes.
bringing
this
topic to us?
Which David do you mean?
Both. All of the above.
Hi there.
This program has been a production of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society. Opinions expressed during this program are those of the individual speaking and not necessarily the opinion of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society.